Jesus was a master of illustrations. And right here in John chapter 3, Jesus is going to teach us four things about salvation from the wind. That's what we're going to be talking about today, so don't go anywhere. Hey, everybody, welcome to Thinking Out Loud with PJ. On this channel, it's my goal to help you think different and help you think biblically. And one of the ways that we can do that is just simply studying Scripture. Today, we want to continue our verse-by-verse study through the book of John. We're in John chapter 3. And like I said, we are going to learn four things that Jesus taught us about salvation just by using the wind as an illustration. Before we jump into this, though, I would love it if you would grab yourself a pen and a notebook to help you, just something to take notes with. Also, grab a Bible. If you don't have a Bible, you can download one. There's a link in the description for a free app that works great. I'm going to be reading out of the ESV, so if you don't have an ESV, again, just grab that app and you can follow along that way. Also, I really want you to take these studies and find a friend that you can study with. So make sure you share this, invite some people to watch it with you, have a discussion around it. Maybe you get together with some friends and watch it and talk about it. But please find yourself a friend that you can study with, because a friend is also going to have to continue to encourage you to think biblically and to think different. Let's jump right into it. And we're going to do that today by way of quick review. So we are now into John chapter 3, and we have been introduced to a man named Nicodemus. And this man, Nicodemus, was a Pharisee, a teacher of the Jews. And if you remember from our other studies, and by the way, if you're brand new, I will throw a link right up here that you can find the playlist and find the rest of these Bible studies so you can catch up with us. But Nicodemus came to Jesus in the night, and he was curious about who Jesus was. And he asked Jesus about salvation. And Jesus does not give him the answer that he thought that he would get, right? Jesus says this crazy thing. He says, you must be born again. You have to be born again to enter the kingdom of God, or even to see the kingdom of God. And so Nicodemus doesn't understand that. And he says, how in the world can I enter again into my mother's womb? I can't do that. Well, we know that's not possible. But we learned in the last video, Jesus says you have to be born again because we are dead in our sins. We need new life. Then we need to be born of the Spirit and of the water. That's not talking about baptism for salvation. We learn that there's the picture of water in the Bible is washing, is cleansing of our sins. And so we have learned through Jesus' interaction with Nicodemus that the way that we can be saved is through new birth. And through new birth, we are washed, we are cleansed. If we want to have a new life, if we want to be rid of the sin that is plaguing us, we have to receive Christ as our Savior. We have to be born again. And that's really where we find ourselves here today. We find ourselves continuing this conversation. And I'm going to just look at one verse today, one verse, and we're going to look at John chapter 3, verse 8 is the only verse we're going to look at today. Jesus says to Nicodemus, after he tells him he has to be born again, he says, the wind blows where it wishes, and you hear its sound, but you do not know where it comes from or where it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit. So there's some things that Jesus is going to teach us about salvation. And that word there, wind, interestingly enough, in the Greek, that word wind and Spirit, both referring to the Holy Spirit, those can be interchangeable. So Jesus, masterfully here, is going to he's using a word picture here that's great. And so what are we going to learn? Well, here's the first thing that we are going to learn. We are going to learn that the wind blows wherever it wants. Jesus says clearly, he says, the wind blows where it wishes. The wind blows anywhere that it wants. What is it we can learn from that? Well, we learn here that the Holy Spirit, as he is doing his work in this world, he does whatever he wants. We don't have any say-so in that. We don't have any power in that. We don't have to give him permission to do what he wants. He is working through the world and doing whatever it is that he wants to do. He's working his plan. So Jesus first teaches us, he says, the wind blows wherever it wants. So we learn from that that the Holy Spirit blows and just goes and does the thing. He blows wherever he wants. He goes wherever he wants. And he doesn't need our permission. So Jesus is beginning to help Nicodemus understand here that salvation does not come from anything that we can do. It is fully on the Holy Spirit and him working in our lives. And so he just says, look, the Holy Spirit is going to blow as the wind, and it's going to go wherever it wants. So that's the first thing we're going to learn. What's the second thing that we're going to learn? The second thing is, just like wind, we can't see it, but we can hear its sound. We can see its effects. We can see its effects. There are observable effects that the wind has, right? We see the leaves blowing. We hear the flags flapping. We can feel it on our skin. What do we say a lot of times? Right? We look out the window and we say, man, look at the wind. Look at how windy it is. Yet we have never seen the wind. So how do we know how windy the wind is? We know how windy the wind is by how straight the flag is, or how bent over the leaves are, or how much the dust is blowing, right? You're driving down the road in your car, and you know how windy it is, not by what you can feel, or rather not by what you can see, but because you feel the wind blowing on the car. We never have seen wind, but we have seen the effects of wind. And Jesus is teaching us here that we can hear the sound. In other words, there are observable effects that the Holy Spirit has on people through salvation, just as there are observable effects that the wind has around us. So how do we know if somebody's born again? How do we know that someone has become born again? It's because of those observable effects. Okay, we see the effects of the gospel on their life. We see change. We see somebody, we learn that in sin we are dead. Ephesians tells us that. Colossians tells us that. We are dead in our sin. That's why we need new birth. And we see the effects of that new birth, that new life coming onto someone. There should be change. There should be something different. Paul tells us in 2 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away, and behold, all things have become new. Or it says here, the old has passed away, and behold, the new has come. Again, I mentioned it just in the very beginning. If you want real change in your life, you need to be born again. It is this new that the Holy Spirit brings to us, this new life that the Holy Spirit brings to us. And we can know then, we know we're saved because of the change. We feel the change. We understand the change. And eventually, the more we change, the more people around us see the effects of the Holy Spirit blowing in our lives and changing us. The Holy Spirit is changing, and little by little, the things that you used to do, you don't do anymore. And then there's things that you never would have done, and now you begin to do those. Maybe it's simple things. Maybe you just now have this desire to go to church and to be around Christians, and before, you never would have done that. And people will see that change in your life. The people will see bad habits beginning to disappear from your life, and the good habits of the Christian life beginning to enter your life. There's real change because we are a new creation. The old has passed away and the new has come. And Jesus says, he says, number one, the wind, the Holy Spirit is going to go and do what he wants. But second of all, as the Holy Spirit comes and does its work, then we are going to see the effects of that. There are observable effects that we can see. So those are the first two things Jesus teaches us. The third thing that we're going to learn is we don't know where the wind comes from. We don't know where the wind comes from. Now, if you talk to a scientist, right, they're going to tell you how the wind, they're going to talk about weather patterns, and they're going to talk about all those things, and they're going to tell you what causes the wind. Where does the wind come from? Where does this wind come from? We don't know. We don't understand that. We can't grasp that. There's a great mystery in the wind that we don't understand. I live in Michigan. I live on the west side of Michigan. And when the storms come across the lake, they blow across. The wind blows the storms across from Wisconsin. So we would say, well, where did the wind come from? Well, the wind came from Wisconsin. But if you live in Wisconsin, where did the wind come? The wind came from further west. And the further west you go, that's where the wind came from. So what we understand here, what we begin to know and to see is that we just don't have a grasp on where the wind originated from. This emphasizes, Jesus wants to emphasize that we have no control over the wind. What do our weather people do? They don't create weather. They don't determine the weather. They just try to predict the weather. They try to predict what the wind is doing because that's really our weather patterns come from that, right? They come from the way the wind is blowing. So you and I, we cannot have any control over the wind. And Jesus is going to emphasize that for us in Mark chapter 6, verses 26 and 27. He says, the kingdom of heaven is as if a man should scatter seed on the ground. He sleeps and rises night and day, and the seed sprouts and grows. He does not know how. Now, again, you might be watching this, and you're thinking, well, of course we know how you plant it and all these things happen, and right? But who made that happen? God made that happen. If God decides that those seeds are not going to grow, those seeds are not going to grow. That's the beauty of farming. That's the amazing thing about farming is farmers put so much trust, whether they believe in God or not, they're putting trust in the order that God has created. They're putting trust in the life that God gives, even to plants. And he says, you plant, but you don't really know how it grows. Why? Because God is the one that grows it. And the illustration that we're seeing here now is we're beginning to understand we have nothing to do with our own salvation. We have nothing to do with other people's salvation. We kind of come right back to John chapter 3 and verse 5. And it says, Jesus answered, truly, truly, I say to you, unless one is born of water and a spirit, he cannot enter the kingdom of God. So you have to enter the kingdom of God by being born of the water and the spirit. We talked about that. But it's also comes from man planting seeds. It comes from us as humans. God has designed it that you and I are the ones who are the preachers of the gospel. We spread the seeds. And as we spread the seeds, then God grows those seeds into salvation. But the clear message here is we don't know how that happens. The Holy Spirit does it. We just do what we're told, and the Holy Spirit does the rest. We see that we scatter the seed, and then God gives new birth. There's not one thing that we can do to earn our salvation. That's the great message here. Really, there's a message here for two people. There's a message here for the Christian saying, if you are trying to witness to somebody, all we can do is plant seeds. God is going to do the rest. And maybe you've been planting seeds and you've been witnessing and you've been rejected and you're discouraged and you're frustrated. Don't get frustrated. It's not you. God is the one who does the work. But also, if you're watching and you're thinking, man, I would love to know what it means to be saved. I would love to be rid of my sin. I would love to have this new life. We have to understand, Jesus is saying, there is nothing you can do. God is the one that does the work. The Holy Spirit is the one that does the work. The wind blows, and we don't know where it comes from. You know what else we don't know? Jesus teaches us a fourth thing. He says, we don't know where the wind goes. We don't know where it comes from. We don't know where it goes. The wind is mysterious. We don't have a full grasp of what God is doing in the world. We might look at somebody and wonder, why is God not doing this in their life? But we don't know where the wind is going. We don't know where the Holy Spirit is going. We don't know what he's doing. We can't harness that power. We cannot direct that power. Think about the wind and how helpless we are as humans to even understand it. We say we build windmills to bring wind power. We have boats with sails. But if the wind isn't blowing, those do us no good. We have really no power. We say we harness the wind, but we can't harness the wind. The wind does exactly what the wind wants to do. It comes from where it wants to come from, and it goes where it wants to go, and we have no say-so over that. And Jesus is saying here to Nicodemus, the Holy Spirit is the same way. It's going to come from where it wants to come from, and it's going to go where it wants to go. Jesus, as he's speaking here, finishes up, and he says, so it is with the Spirit. All right, so it is with the Spirit. The same as the Spirit does what the Spirit wants. It's powerful. It's strong. We can see it working. We can know the Spirit is working, but the Spirit is the same as the wind. What this teaches me, guys, this teaches me that we are just along for the ride. And this might seem frustrating. This might seem, in some ways, even maybe a little bit humiliating or defeating, but it's not. It's encouraging because I am not a good salesman. Right? I'm a human and I fail. I fail when I give the gospel. I fail to say the right words. I fail sometimes to see the right open doors. But Jesus is saying the Holy Spirit works and he's the one that does the work. We're just along for the ride when it comes to the Great Commission. So why that encourages me is I say, I have to be that farmer. I don't know what God does with the seed. I don't know how he uses it. I don't know when the time is going to be that this person that I'm trying to reach with the gospel is finally going to receive Christ as their Savior. I don't know, because I don't know where the wind is coming from. I don't know where the wind is going. But I know the power in that wind. And I know that if I'm planting seeds, God will grow those seeds, and he's going to accomplish with those seeds what it is that he wants. I want us to look at one more verse here. One more passage of scripture, rather, in Galatians. The Lord has really been encouraging me with this lately. Galatians chapter 6, 7 through 10. Paul writes here, he says, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, or whatever one sows, that will he also reap. For one who sows to his own flesh will from the flesh reap corruption. But the one who sows of the Spirit will of the Spirit reap eternal life. And let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, especially to those who are the household of faith." So what is it that the Lord has been encouraging me with, that the Lord has been teaching me? And that is this, exactly what we've been talking about today. I don't know what the Lord is going to do. I don't know where the Spirit's blowing. I don't know where it's coming from. I don't know where it's going. But I know that if I am faithful to sow seeds, God is faithful to do the growing of seeds. Whatever a man sows, that he will reap. If I'm sowing of my flesh, if I'm sowing of my own selfishness, those are the things I'm going to reap. But if I'm sowing in the Spirit as the Spirit blows, if I'm allowing God to work through me and I'm sowing spiritual seeds, I'm witnessing, I'm discipling, I'm investing in the lives of people, I don't know how it happens and I don't know where it's going to happen, but God is going to grow those seeds and I'm going to have the privilege to reap those seeds and reap those benefits. Can I encourage you guys today? Can I encourage you Christians, first of all? I'm going to encourage you that this is good news for us. When Jesus says the Holy Spirit does what the Holy Spirit wants to do, that's encouraging for us because it takes all of the responsibility of making sure we say the right things. It takes it all off from me and it puts it on God. And God is able to handle that. God is powerful. It doesn't take responsibility of the Great Commission. It doesn't take that off of me. But it means that I need to plant the seeds. That's all I'm called to do is plant the seeds. So be encouraged today. If there's somebody you're trying to reach and they just don't seem to be getting it, just let the Holy Spirit do its work. We don't know where it's coming from. We don't know where it's going. That's a mystery that's not for us to know. But we can know that we can plant and we can water. And in God's time, we can reap that harvest. Maybe you're watching this today and you have never received Christ as your Savior. You don't have that new birth. You're still living it with the struggles of your sin. You can't do anything to fix that. God is the one, this Holy Spirit that blows into our lives that gives us that new birth. You need new birth today. And if you have not, if you don't have that, I trust you're studying with somebody. If you're studying with somebody, reach out to them. Otherwise, you can drop a comment for me, and I would love to have a greater conversation with you as to what it means to be a Christian. Thanks so much for watching. Thanks for being a part of this study. Like I said, this is an ongoing study. So if you're brand new, grab the playlist and just catch up. There's several videos there and you can take your time and catch up. Make sure you're doing that with a friend. That would be great. But also I want to encourage you, if this was a blessing to you, hit the like button. That stirs the YouTube algorithms and it will push the video out to other people so they can be encouraged to share it. Share it so that other people will see it. And then please let me know. It's encouraging to me to know how God is using this in your life. So if God is encouraging you through this video or through this Bible study, let me know in the comments how God is encouraging you. And of course, if you haven't subscribed, which by the way, my algorithms tell me that I have more people watching that have not subscribed, so that's probably you. Click the subscribe button, hit the little bell. You guys know the drill. We'll see you next time.